Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's devotions. I want to continue to think about meditation and continue in Psalm 119. And going to just read a little bit further on from where we were the other day. So I'm going to read from verse 105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to observe your righteous ordinances. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. Amen. That's God's word for us. Well, in our previous devotions, we've noted how meditating on God's word brings understanding or wisdom, and that wisdom enables or equips the believer to live a blameless life. This section of Psalm 119 once again highlights the intimate connections between meditating on God's word and living a godly life. It also highlights the security that only comes from meditating on God's word, from knowing it so that it works its way into our hearts and minds and shapes our life actions and responses. Verse 105 is unquestionably one of the best known verses of the Psalm and perhaps from the Bible itself. It's normally understood to be a text about divine guidance, and I know from past experience it often features prominently in books about guidance. But actually, it's not a text about divine guidance at all. In the Bible, the words lamp and light are not associated with guidance as a theme, but are connected more with the idea of safety in the context of danger. The same themes are found in Psalm 142, verse 3, where the psalmist writes, "In the path where I walk, they have hidden a trap for me." As part of my kit for walking on the Via della Plata, I bought a good quality head torch. It's a necessary piece of kit if you have to get up through the night, the hostels in pitch darkness. But also, when it can still be quite dark when you leave the hostel in the morning to start walking the Camino. Apart from the danger of missing one of the hand-painted yellow arrows, there's a very real danger of tripping and falling on the uneven terrain and causing a Camino-ending injury. If you twisted your ankle or something like that, or hurt your knee in some way, you would not be able to walk the Camino at all. It's over 1,000 kilometres, couldn't be done. In a similar way, the lamp and light of Scripture are not so much needed to provide divine guidance about which choices to make in life, but rather are needed to keep the believer from straying off the path and into danger. The point is that I do not need a lamp or light to choose whether or not to step to the left or to the right. I need them so that I do not stumble as I keep going straight. In the context of the Psalm, I need the lamp of God's word because I live in a world that would otherwise make me stumble into danger and off the path of righteousness. In another psalm, we find the same idea of light keeping us safe from danger. In Psalm 56 and 13, we read, "For you have delivered my soul from death, yes, my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of life." Christopher Ashe has written that although we tend to use this text as a proof text for guidance, the truth of the matter is that for the most part, the Bible does not directly help us with our guidance. We pretend it does, but actually it doesn't. It helps us with simple questions. Should I murder my neighbour? Now, the Bible answers that one. Our tendency is to always want a quick and easy fix. So we want the Bible to tell us what to do in everyday life decisions. Who should we marry? What job should we take? What should I have for breakfast? And there are many books written on how to find divine guidance, especially for major life decisions. But actually, the Bible does not so much tell us how God guides us. Rather, the Bible tells us who God guides. The Bible tells us about the character, the kind of person who experiences or knows the guidance of God. The psalmist is telling us that God's word provides a light for the path of righteousness so that we don't stumble into doing wrong. So the word of God is not a career guidance manual, but a lamp that keeps me walking in the way of the Lord, to protect me from the traps of darkness and to keep me from falling into sin. As such, the psalmist knows that he needs a godly determination to keep walking in the path and keep looking to the word to light the path for him. And so it's as he does that, as he keeps walking in the way of the Lord, the guidance that he needs for daily decisions comes readily to hand. Such determined faithfulness brings, of course, its own problems. The psalmist finds himself afflicted once more because of his faithfulness. In fact, in verse 109, he says, "I hold my life in my hand continually." This is a cultural idiom which has basically the same meaning as our phrase, taking your life in your hands. It's used in 1 Samuel 8 and verse 21, when the witch of Endor initially refuses to raise Samuel's spirit from the grave because the king had forbidden such witchcraft. And if she did that, she'd be taking her life into her hands. And so it's to act in a way that brings risk. What he's saying here is that just meditating on the word of God and allowing that to really change your life, well, you're taking your life into your hands, because that means that you will live in a certain way and make certain choices that other people will not like. This very video devotion has the capacity to be broadcast to every country in the world. Except that as a Christian message from the Bible, it would be banned in many countries where Christians are persecuted for their faith. In some countries, the act of owning a Bible, the act of meeting someone for prayer, is literally taking your life into your hands. But the psalmist also knows that there is an eternal reward, a heritage. And here he uses an expression from the Old Testament to speak of the inheritance of the promised land. Furthermore, he knows that faithfulness to the word leads to our deepest joy, because the deepest joy we can know is to be found in knowing God and walking in his ways. Oh, the world will tell us lots of other things, you know. If you have this thing, this latest thing, then you will be really happy. If you do that thing, well, that's going to bring you great joy. Sin promises so much, but it delivers so little. The Bible delivers, because in the Bible we find, we come, we meet with God. God is revealed to us in his word. We come to know him. And in coming to know him, we find our deepest joy. That joy that leads us to that guaranteed heritage, the promised land. And hard as it is better, the psalmist knows, it is better to suffer for walking in the way of the Lord, in accordance with his word, keeping his statutes and his ordinances, his precepts and his commands, and letting them shape our life and behaviour. It is better to do that than to leave the path of righteousness, even if that seems to offer an easier life. There's lots of attractions on either side of that path, but God's word is the searchlight, the beam that illuminates that path for us, that we might walk in the way of the Lord. It's better to do that than walk in the way of the ungodly, even if the way of the ungodly seems to offer an easier life. Didn't Jesus say, "What do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Is anything worth more than your soul?" Thanks for listening.